I lose, I will follow. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow.
Good morning. Oh my, let's try that one again on this Sunday after Easter. Good morning.
Good morning.
Christ is risen.
He is risen.
That's better. It is great to have you here for worship this morning. Bit of a gray, cold, rainy day outside, but the light of Jesus Christ is present here in this place of worship, and we're just so glad to be together. I have to tell you, it's been a really full weekend here in the life of the church. Friday night, we had our Sticky Faith parenting. Great to see some of our parents with young kids here learning about what does it mean to grow as a parent. And then Saturday, we had an amazing team of people who were polishing, cleaning, scrubbing in anticipation for our 150th. So thank you to the team of people who showed up. Very cool to see this cleaning group, but at the same time, the food shelf was active with serving our community with food. Downstairs, Family Values had a single parent event downstairs. AA was all over in the children's wing, and you just saw like the community here. And it was really a gift to see the fullness of life. It's also exciting to be able to celebrate not only new life in Jesus Christ here within our building, but as you see this rose here, it turns out that Mariah's water broke just shortly after Easter worship on Sunday. And 2 days later, she delivered a beautiful little girl by the name of Andy Elizabeth on April the 2nd. So we're really excited about this new life and praying God's blessing on this family. And we're really pleased this morning to have our guest preacher with us, Reverend William Johnson, but known to many of you as Billy. And he's got his own group of guests who have come just to hear him preach. So welcome to you who are his kind of fan club. And we're glad that you're here. What you should know, those of you who are a little bit newer to the church. So Bill grew up in First Covenant Church. He met his wife, Janine, here, who's with us. Their youngest son is here this morning, Lucas. And again, a number of family and friends have gathered as well. And he served Covenant churches throughout the Midwest and is now serving at Crown University. So we're thrilled to hear this message that's actually been on his heart and mind for quite a while now, specifically for First Covenant about church done right. So I trust that the Holy Spirit will be active and present, is active and present among us now, and we have the opportunity to sing together. What a beautiful name. So I ask that you please stand.
Thank you. Eternal God, our Alpha and Omega, our beginning and our end, we have gathered in this time and at this place to worship you. In your time, you created all things and wove into their fabric a yearning for fulfillment in you. It is this yearning within us which has pulled us here this morning. Take these moments, O Lord of time and space, and complete them in us. Through your Holy Spirit, may our labor bring forth a new creation in you. This is your hour, Christ Jesus. Help us to make the most of each precious moment. For in your name we have gathered, and we pray, as you taught your disciples to pray, by saying, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated. In a moment, we will be hearing from Diane and Sarah about the Team World Vision 6K. But first, let's watch this video together.
Millions of girls like Mahana walk up to 6 kilometers every day for water that can make them sick. That's 3.7 miles. And what's in the water isn't the only threat. As they walk, they risk abuse, trafficking, and dangerous animals. Flooding or falling can lead to drownings. And the time spent walking means girls miss school or drop out entirely. Entire futures, gone. Globally, 703 million people lack basic drinking water access. That's why at World Vision, our passion for clean water runs deep. Deep enough to reach one new person every 10 seconds and 3 more schools every day with clean water. So girls can be in class, moms can run households and businesses, and kids can be healthy. Join World Vision's Global 6K for Water and change lives by bringing clean water access to those who need it most.
Good morning, FCC. I'm Diane Carlson, the captain this year here at the 6K, and Sarah's the co-captain. We are so excited. This is our 7th year hosting the 6K.
We'll be gathering this year on Saturday, May 18th at our church, and we will walk, run, move our feet 3.7 miles around our beautiful neighborhood and Lake Phelan. This is a great opportunity to not only have a super fun morning, but also to join together in bringing clean water access to those who need it across the world.
To sign up, you can either scan the QR code up on the screen or it's in the weekly email. And we do have a table that you can stop by after the service. We'd be happy to answer any questions. There is a discount code that is valid until the 10th for $15 off your registration, so I would say sign up soon. Using the code CLEANWATER, it's right there as well. If you would like to volunteer instead of joining us out on the course, we need those as well. Volunteers help it run as well. We'll have more details to come in the coming weeks, and we hope to see you at the table. Thanks.
Good morning. We'll be reading today from 2 Timothy chapter 1, verses 3 through 7, then 13, then 14. I thank God, whom I serve, as my ancestors did, with a clear conscience, as night and day I constantly remember you in my prayers. Recalling your tears, I long to see you, so that I may be filled with joy.
I am reminded of your sincere faith, which first lived in your grandmother Lois and in your mother Eunice, and, I am persuaded, now lives in you also.
For this reason, I remind you to fan into flame the gift of God, which is in you through the laying on of my hands. For the Spirit that God gave us does not make us timid, but gives us power, love, and self-discipline.
What you heard from me, keep as the pattern of sound teaching, with faith and love in Christ Jesus. Guard the good deposit that was entrusted to you. Guard it with the help of the Holy Spirit who lives in us. May God add a blessing to the reading of the word.
This next song is called Firm Foundation, You Won't. And we've only done it
once before, so we're doing it again today. And just to let you know, this song will also be done in worship on the 150th April 21st for worship service. So please learn it well. Let's stand and sing Firm Foundation, He Won't. Amen. You may be seated.
am the Minister of Formation and Connection here at First Covenant, and I have a few updates about our life together. As you've probably caught the glimpse of it by now, in just 2 weeks, we're celebrating our 150th, and we are getting really, really excited about it. From the many pieces that are coming together, from our community celebration on Saturday to our celebrative worship in this place on Sunday the 21st, there is a lot to celebrate about God's faithfulness through our last 150 years. One thing you may not be aware of is the amount of musical ensembles that we'll be sharing as part of our 150-year-long story over this weekend. If you look behind me, you'll see that we've just got a week of rehearsals coming up. We had Lucia Singers yesterday. We have our cast, our musical cast ensemble, both today after Spiritual Growth Hour and then next Sunday. Our gospel choir is practicing on Monday. It's not too late to join us as we sing Hallelujah together. And there's more up there. You can just see there's a lot of preparation going on. We invite you to make sure that you're inviting others to this time. Find places where you can be involved and join us for one of these rehearsals that you may or may not already be a part of. As we look ahead, before we get to the 150th, next weekend is a really special weekend in our life together. As you may know, we've been in the process of searching for a new minister of youth and families, and our candidate, Scott Nitschke, is visiting us next weekend. We've got a couple of key opportunities for you to get to know Scott over that weekend. On Saturday the 13th at Pastor Ann and Gordy's house, families of youth and of children are invited to join us for coffee and donuts for an open house style gathering. The weather's going to be great, we just know it. To get to know Scott a little bit better, whether you're going to currently be in youth ministry or coming up into our youth ministry, we want to make sure that you're joining us. Come anytime during those 2 hours. Scott will be with us in worship. You'll have the opportunity to get to know him better there. And then he'll be joining us during that cast rehearsal and for pizza following with youth. So 6th through 12th graders, make sure you're joining us for that rehearsal. You don't want to miss it for so many reasons, including getting to know Scott at the end of it. Next Sunday, we'll also have a brief congregational meeting following worship to affirm new members, so make sure that you're here and that you're able to pause here for a couple of minutes before we go on to the rest of spiritual growth and other activities that morning. And then looking further ahead into the month, want to make sure that our families with 2nd through 5th graders remember that we have a communion class coming up. Part of our rhythm and routine with our children's ministry is to offer this regular opportunity every other year for these young people to get to understand the meaning of communion better. And then they'll get to participate in it the first Sunday of May. So save the date. If you've got questions, please talk to Laura or to Pastor Ann. Meanwhile, we are continuing on in this body together in worship, and I am going to invite the choir forward at this time as we continue on to sing Cathedral of Praise.
Thank you, choir. As the choir makes their way down, I would invite the preschool through second graders to continue their worship experience in Children's Church, and you may stand and pass the peace of Christ with those around you.
I'm going to encourage you to find your places. You'll have plenty of time to talk following worship in our fellowship time. I want to give ample time for Reverend Bill Johnson to be able to bring us the word this morning. So, Billy, welcome.
I'm delighted to be here in this place and to be with you. I'm going to cry right at the beginning. I'm sunk already. But I'm delighted to be here and to be with you today. And Anne, thank you for the opportunity. It's a privilege and an honor. A lot of life has flown underneath the bridge since those seminary days, huh? In Carmen apartments across the courtyard from each other. Wow. As I preach today, I'll be preaching to you and with you and to myself, but I'm also going to be preaching to those who I've known, who I've loved, and who are gone. So I'm preaching to both here today. And I'm going to testify to love, and I'm going to shine thanks on all those I've known in this place. I'm going to reminisce a bit. And there's a reason for that. Hopefully it will become clear as I go through my message. But I got to go quick. 60 years packed into a 25-minute message, so I got to go quick. And I'm going to disappear for a moment. I'm going to walk to the back of the church, and there'll be a reason for that as well. But as pastors, we learn that when we start out a sermon, we're supposed to find a struggle that we can connect with the congregation on. Share a struggle. But when it comes to this topic of church and church done right, I don't have a struggle because I experience the benefit and the beauty and the beautifulness of church done right. It wasn't until later in my ministerial career that I saw the other side of church, the underbelly of church, so to speak, and that threw me for a loop and actually into a depression because I had never known it, I had never seen it, and I couldn't grasp it. I knew how it should be, how it could be, and why isn't it that, right? So, for those of you who haven't experienced church done right, all I can say is I understand, and I'm sorry. But I want to share with you today how it could be, and should be, and was for me. So some say the church is in trouble. I don't think so. I think the church is doing fine, and it always will do fine. I think it's our thinking about the church and our experience in the church that can cause us a little bit of trouble in our lives. But there's power in the church gathered and in the church scattered. And I want to share with you on that today. And I have one point. It's going to be kind of all over the place, but I'm going to try to go back to this one point. I believe in one point preaching. And here it is. You cannot even imagine the power you have to influence and love people to faith. But first, let me start with this long introduction of another little point. I hope you'll get the connection. But it's this. We know that faith is taught, but it's also caught. And I want to explain this here as I take a little walk down there and back. Is that okay with you? All right. I could preach a whole sermon, several, on this sanctuary alone. This is one of the most beautiful sanctuaries in the Twin Cities and one of the most beautiful in the covenant. I mean, just take in the stained glass and the stories it tells. This is a beautiful place. And in 1951, sorry, you don't have to turn your heads. I won't take it personally if you're not looking at me. But in 1951, they bought this whole block on the east side of St. Paul for $5,400. And back here, and I won't go out the door, as I trace my fingers on it this morning, 1951, the cornerstone. There's my grandpa, Art Johnson, with Pastor Carl Gideon Charn laying the cornerstone for this sanctuary. Could my grandpa have imagined back then how important this sanctuary would become to me? And then right here, the doors would open on Sunday mornings and there'd be a choir standing out here, 50 people strong or more, and they would sing an introit. And you knew something special was about to happen. And there was a formality to it and a looking forward to what was going to be coming. And right over here in this area, I used to sit with my dad when I was a little boy. You see, I was a little too shy and scared to go to Sunday school, so I didn't go all the time. But I would sit in this sanctuary with my dad. I'd snuggle up close, and I caught the faith. And I knew God was big and beautiful and mysterious, and this incredible music and the love I felt here. God must be loving, and he's big and beautiful. A little mystic was born in this sanctuary. My call to ministry formed right over here. And then on the left side, by the way, this is the right side of the church. I sat over here more often than that side. But on this side, and here they are today. My family would sit. My grandparents, Art and Jeanette, would sit right here. The heritage and the legacy I have in this church just by their model of their piety for me. And to honor them this morning, Tregari Kaningin Vora, Helsgud Lila Borna Skora, Starnan E Pa Himla Festet, Fogen E Kandanestet, in honor of them, the legacy and the heritage of faith passed on, you read it in Timothy, from generation to generation to generation. We thought we'd get away from our family a little bit, but as teenagers, we sat about here. We didn't get too far. Why didn't we sit up in the balcony or something? And then right about here, we'd sit for confirmation in our white robes with red carnations, sweating like pigs. Why? Because we would have to say something by memory. We were all dreading it. Ed Halston gave Janine a verse. She remembers hers, Philippians 4:8. I don't remember mine at that time, but it was beautiful. And then I remember standing here and sitting there and being here, and at the benediction at the end, I would look at Jesus, and it's peaceful and beautiful. Oh, God loves me, and I'll get through this week with him, and he'll be with me. And then this baptismal font, it was actually down here back in the day. And in 1964, Norbert Johnson said these words when he baptized me at this font. Billy is now received into the nurture and care of the Christian church. See what manner of love the Father has bestowed on us, that we should be called children of God, and that's what we are. And this congregation didn't say it flippantly. They lived out their baptismal vows in my life. And today, even me being here, I am proof of it. And then even in the front of this church, all those who I've loved and lost, except for my sister Patty, all the coffins would be right here. And our hearts would be comforted by the preaching and the word and the community. And then you know what we did too back in the day? There was offering plates. And people actually gave money. And it went something like this after that happened. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. With me. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. And every Sunday we were reminded where all good gifts come from and how blessed we are. And on this platform right here, I was in the Little Singers. 8 years old, 9 years old. And here's what we did. It's going to rain, 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 rain. It's going to rain, 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 rain. It's about Noah's Ark, by the way. It's going to rain, 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 rain. 100% chance of rain. And Janine's mom directed that choir. And at 8 years old, I fell in love with a 9-year-old girl on this platform. And it took me many years later to get her to date me and finally marry me in the day, but there she was, Janine. And I tell you, youth group and church was fun, but when Janine was there, and I love Jesus, but when Janine was there, it was a lot more fun. Janine, if I know what love is, God's love and human love, it is because of you. And many say it was puppy love, but I'll just say this, man, it's real to the puppy. If you know what I mean, huh? And then there was a lectern over here. And every Sunday, Old Testament lesson, psalm, gospel, epistle. And as a little boy, I just took it in. And it fed me in ways I didn't even know. But it does something to you when you go through the lectionary for years and years and years. And then this communion table. Oh, grace poured through here. Come to this table not because you must, but because you may. Not because you are strong, but because you are weak. Come not to express an opinion, but to seek his presence and pray for his spirit. Here I ate and tasted and drank grace. And then the choir loft. Oh, Harry Opal, Bonnie. Harry was a little scary to me as a little boy, but he was beautiful. And he probably affected my faith in some ways more than others because each Sunday, Beethoven, Bach, Mozart, again, I caught the beauty of God in all of that. I felt it. And after a prayer on the Sunday morning, they would even, and I remember this to this day, Father, hear the prayer we offer, not for ease that prayer may be, but for strength that we shall ever live our lives courageously. It shaped me. It formed me. And the weddings of my two kids who wanted to get married in this church was special to me. And then there was a big pulpit right here. Where is that big pulpit? It's in there. There was a big pulpit right there. And these men in black robes, who I thought were God, would walk up into that pulpit. Norbert Johnson walked into that pulpit. And again, I was a little shy and sometimes didn't go so much to Sunday school, but one day somebody asked me, after I did go to Sunday school, said, Billy, Elaine Johnson taught my Sunday school class. Billy, who taught your Sunday school class? She was Norbert's wife. And I said, oh, God's wife. The awe, the reverence, these men who were special to me and loved me. They weren't high on a pedestal, but heart to heart, huh? Ed Halston preached here, and I remember at Christmas time, there'd be 50-foot tall trees here, and we put red bulbs on those. And I think with my Uncle Chuck and Jimmy, we would always on that pulpit hang one little red bulb on the microphone. Just it reminded us of Ed Halston somehow and his bald head. But each morning, he would take that off, and it would be removed. And then Bill Peterson, who gave me three of the most profound words for my life, trust and proceed. And he brought some formality and dignity and respect, and he made me wear a robe whenever I did something back in the day. So in honor of these three preachers that I have loved, I never got to wear one of these in my ministry in Naperville and Monticello. So I'd like to wear it today in honor of them. Does something magical happen when you put this on? Maybe we'll see by the end of my sermon today. Do you hear it? They gave me a space. They gave me experiences. They gave me songs. They gave me hymns. 500 voices or so singing and reading scripture and singing the songs. They gave me a model. They gave me example. They gave me Jesus. It made such a difference. It shaped me. It formed me. A sure and firm foundation. Faith is more caught than taught. So that just gives you a little bit of a glimpse of the impact that a church can have being done right. Now let's get to the text, and I'll make some comments on that briefly. I'm going to walk through one verse, and there it is. Paul is writing to the believers at Thessalonica. He's writing from Corinth, and he's actually been smuggled out of the city a little bit before in a basket. He caused trouble there in the city. He had to get out of there. But in this letter, there's such a feeling of endearment and care and affection that Paul is writing to the believers at that church. And it's about practical matters of the Christian faith. So how is the church to be the church? And how is church done right? Here it is. We loved you so much. We were delighted to share with you not only the gospel of God, but our lives as well, because you had become so dear. So let's take it phrase by phrase. We loved you so much. Right there, we have it. The one thing, right at the beginning, is what? Love. And you've heard that phrase, the main thing is to keep the main thing, the main thing. This is the main thing in the church, love. And in Galatians 5:6, it says the only thing that matters is faith expressing in love. It's not rocket science. There it is. We have it. The church is about love. And I think there's two things about this love. First, it's heartfelt. It's experienced. It's not just knowledge up here, but it's a feeling here, I think. Heartfelt love and affection. And in covenant pietism, our forebears and forefathers and mothers, they had an expression. They would say, is your heart warmed by the love of Christ? And it was here in this environment that I grew up in. It was that heartfeltness of love, and they let it overflow into my life and the lives of so many others. That's the first thing. It's heartfelt. The second thing about this love is it's an expressed love. So the summary of the Christian life, experience God's love, express God's love. Oh. And we know the Savior, right? We know who that is, right? Christ and his forgiveness, mercy, and grace. But could it be that we also save each other through love in some way, that we are saviors to each other? Now, I'm not talking codependently or unhealthily, but beautifully. We save each other through love. We put a deposit of love in others that lasts and has effects. We build up and pour out love in the lives of others, and it builds up this reservoir of love. That was my experience here. And it has had effects throughout my life. Love repairs and prepares. And in this place, it repaired me and prepared me. And the interesting thing about this love is we can't really give it to ourselves. It's planted in us, deposited in us, poured into us by others. And that kind of love saves. We loved you so much. Do you catch the so much? It's that feeling of affection, like a father and a mother, the word that's used, a father and a mother caring and loving their young child. Tenderness, fondness, affection. So it's not even so much what people did in this place, though it was that. It was this feeling, and I can't really explain it, but it was a sense of feeling accepted, affirmed, a fondness and endearment, that spirit of love. We love people to faith. So that's the first. We loved you so much, and then what comes? We were delighted to share. And just take that word delight for a moment. In experiencing and expressing God's love, the people, the saints, the community I knew here, the church, they delighted to share. And it wasn't duty. Maybe it was, but I didn't feel it. It wasn't duty. It wasn't drudgery. It was delight. And there's a quote that I came across that says, joy is the infallible sign of the presence of God. I saw it. I saw God in them and their joy to share and to give. We're made to love, you know. Created in love, by love, for love, to love, through love, to love. And when we feel that purpose, we come alive, and there's joy, and there's happiness. When we don't, it's like the Dead Sea stopped up. There's a loneliness, a uselessness, a sadness, a guilt. I saw joy in them as they experienced it and expressed it, even to me. Are you with me out there? We loved you so much that we were delighted to share with you. Share what? The gospel of God. What is the gospel? It's good news. Kerygma, remember back in the day? Proclamation, Christ has died. Christ has risen. Christ will come again. Simplified, Jesus shows us this. The three most important words in Scripture, 1 John 4:7, God is love. Not God is love and, not God is love but, God is only love. And Jesus shows us that God looks at us with nothing but love. Not anger, not disappointment, not disapproval, not judgment, not wrath, but love. Now that's a message that can change a life. It changed mine. So a little bit on that good news and on that love, it's overwhelming. And we think we know it, but Scripture says it's beyond what you can know. Again, it goes back to that experience. We cannot understand how much our Heavenly Father loves us, for there is no parallel in our experience of this world to help us understand it. There's nothing on earth with which it can compare, and nothing we have ever felt apart from Him resembles it ever so faintly. We see it most clearly in Christ, who God is, and God's love. But in this world, we only get glimpses, right? So take the best parent or friend, multiply their love 1,000 times. We're still not even getting close. You can't even imagine how loved you are. It's overwhelming. God's love is never ending. You know Ephesians 1:4, God chose to love us before the world was even created. It's everlasting. It's never ending. It's eternal. Jeremiah 31, I have loved you with an everlasting love. And nothing can separate us from His love in Romans 8, right? Amazing. So God is loving us right now, even though we're unaware of it. Right now, in this moment, you are encircled by God's never-ending loving embrace. Right now, in this moment, without a single thing changing, the love of God is radiating to you and within you without question, without limit, without reservation. And right now, in this moment, to know that love, experience it, is happiness, joy, and peace. Wow. And then God's love is reckless. Throwing caution to the wind, right? In Christ, God enters the world, and He gives us Himself to hear, to see, to touch, to hold. As it says in John, the Gospel of John, we've seen Him, we've heard Him, we've touched Him. We're passing this on so you'll believe too. Amazing, overwhelming, never-ending, and reckless. Do you know this love? My boring faith story is this. I never remember not knowing Jesus. My grandparents, my parents, generations in 1 Timothy, it was natural. It was the sea I swam in, and I came to my own faith in all of that. All I knew, in some crazy times going on in my home at times, all I knew is that God loved me, He cared for me, was with me, He understood me, and He would help me through as a little boy into this day. Where did I get that? I was taught it here, and I caught it here. I came to church and fell in love with God through people who fell in love with God and shared that love with me. Church done right. We loved you so much. We were delighted to share not only the gospel of God, but our lives as well. You've heard the story of that little girl afraid to sleep alone in a dark room on a scary, stormy night. She calls out to her mom, who tells her that Jesus is right beside her. She replies, "Well, Mom, but right now I need Jesus with skin on." Don't we all? August 10th, 1977, I was 13 years old. I went to Covenant Pines for the first time. I never really wanted to go too far away from home because I thought something bad would happen if I left. All of a sudden, one day, I'm shooting archery out on the range. A guy taps me on the shoulder, brings me into this cabin in this room, and I walk in, and I see my older brother, Greg, and my older sister, Kathy. They said, "Billy, Dad has died." And he died of a massive heart attack at work on a Saturday. He actually went down then and mailed me a letter, went back to his office, and dropped dead. I received a letter from my dead dad 3 or 4 days later. But I remember we drove home, and Mark Holmberg was with me at that time. Mark, I love you. You're special to me for that. But I remember, and this is another sermon for another time, I remember running up the sidewalk and there my mom was waiting for me. Now that's significant, and maybe another time. But I was in my room, you know, crying, trying to figure it out, and guess who walks into my room but this bald-headed pastor named Ed Halston. His first week on the job, and in fact it might have been his first day on the job, I don't know. And I didn't know I would become a pastor at that time. But if I did, I knew from that moment what a pastor should do. Show up. Love, care, listen, and give hope. And he did that for me. Ed, thank you. And many years later, he became my pastoral care professor at North Park Seminary. God has a sense of humor, I think. He shared his life with me. He was a savior to me. At that same time, there was a cool college Bethel hockey player with a beautiful wife named Susanna. And his name was Scott Johnson. And for some reason, Scott took me under his wing. He taught me how to play guitar. We led singing in Sunday school. He introduced me to Christian contemporary music through Keith Green. He made me feel special. He wasn't embarrassed by me, and maybe he should have been. He discipled me, but we never went through discipleship material. Never went through a book. He did it with his life. He did it by who he was. He shared his life with me. I saw Jesus in him, and I wanted to be like him. He was a savior to me. He poured that reservoir of love in me, and it's had effects on my life ever since. And it's like, if this is what being in ministry is about, sign me up. Let's go. And you've heard the expression, I'd rather see a sermon than hear one any day. I'd rather one would walk with me than simply tell the way. Well, Scott did that for me. I saw it live there. And then the youth group and youth counselors, and they shared their life with me. Sunday school teachers, Carolyn, Alice, Glass. From afar, Fran Anderson. My sister Janet went on a trip to Appalachia with her. And I was like, oh, wow. And then first thing I did as a youth pastor is I planned a trip to Appalachia. I was so affected and influenced by that. And Fran actually was then a seminary professor of mine. How blessed I've been. Up close, Bruce and Carol Lawson. And I felt their affection for me. And blessed through it. Beth and Denny, their acceptance, their guidance. Youth group counselors, Gary and Meredith Carlson, Grace. The time, the energy, the patience. I was a youth pastor for 14 years. I know how stinky middle schoolers, how insecure, how much time and effort, overnights, this and that. And they did that with me and for me. Why? Because they love me so much. Amazing. You want to prove your love for Jesus, be a youth group counselor for a while, right? Men's breakfast, retired men's group, pancake suppers, youth group events, trips, Hmong ministry. I saw faith lived out everywhere I looked. And St. Francis said, preach the gospel at all times, but if necessary, use words. They didn't have to use a word. They were walking gospels and living epistles. And I was watching. We loved you so much that we gave you not only the gospel of God, but our lives as well. Why? Because you had become so dear to us. Why did they love me and share the gospel in their lives? I have no idea. Maybe they couldn't help it. But I have a guess. You see, my legal name is William Eric Johnson. I'm mostly known as Bill, but I have a nickname. And here in this place, I was, is, and always will be known as Billy, a name of endearment. What was dear about me? I don't know. Not much. What did I have to give back to them? Nothing. I was shy, insecure, afraid, wounded. What benefit was it to them to love me? But somehow I became dear to them, and maybe because they knew my grandparents, and they knew my parents, and they knew more than I realized, and they knew I needed love and safety and sanctuary. In their love, I knew God loved me. In their endearment towards me, I knew I was dear to God. In their fond affection of me, I found God's affection for me. So why is this place and those saints so dear to me? Because I was so dear to them. So what's the application for this? Get ready. Here we go. You are powerful. You cannot imagine the power you have to love people to faith. How did I know I was dear? And this is going to sound a little crazy. You know, I mentioned some big ways, Ed and youth group and Scott and all that, but there's one little absurd way that I knew I was dearly loved. They knew me, they knew who I was, and they smiled at me. They looked at me. They got down to greet me on Sunday morning. And here's what they did. Here it comes. They tousled my hair. I didn't even know who they were. But my grandparents did. My parents did. They knew who I was. We think we have to do such great big things for God. No. The kingdom of God is all about little things like mustard seeds and yeast and pencils. As Mother Teresa, I'm a little pencil in the hands of God who's writing a love letter to the world. God does not call us to do great things, but small things with great love. So you have a task. Step up. Take your place. Fulfill your role. Restore the church. Be the church. Parents, be countercultural. Get your kids to church in a faith community. Pastors, be radical. Teach only love. And inspire that in your community. People, be an example. Be God's pencils. Do little things with great love. And whatever it is, they'll catch a glimpse of Jesus through you. And they're looking, they're watching, just like I was. So sing, cook, usher, greet, landscape. Make coffee. Serve after funerals. Be baby holders. Work in the nursery. You cannot imagine the effect that you're having, so bring it. And to close, a brief story. In the Baltimore slums back in the day, there was a sociology professor, and he did a study on 200 young boys in the Baltimore slums. And he asked to write an evaluation of each boy's future. And they went out and they did that, and each of his students wrote this about each of those boys. He hasn't got a chance. And 25 years later, another professor came through and saw this study, and he wanted to revisit it and see what was going on and how these boys were doing. Out of the 200, there was 180 boys who were still in the area, who grew up into young men, who achieved more than ordinary success as lawyers, doctors, and businessmen. The professor, he was astounded, and he went out, and they were in the area, and he did an interview with them, and he asked them this question: how do you account for your success? And in each reply, it came with deep feeling. They said, there was a teacher. And the teacher was still alive. So the professor sought her out and asked the old but still alert lady what magic formula she had used to pull these boys out of the slums into successful achievement. And the teacher's eyes sparkled, and her lips broke into a gentle smile. "It's really very simple," she said. "I loved those boys." Way back when, they could have looked at me and said, he hasn't got a chance. He hasn't got a chance. He's a scared little boy. He hasn't got a chance. He's an awkward, insecure teenager. He hasn't got a chance to marry the Lucia Queen. He hasn't got a chance to be in ministry. And if you could put that picture up. From the 1974 directory. He hasn't got a chance. He's too shy. He could never be a minister. He hasn't got a chance. He's too timid. He could never be a preacher. How did my life come to be that I could have the privilege to minister all these years as a youth pastor, a senior pastor, a chaplain? And my reply comes with feeling and a smile. There was a pastor. There was a Sunday school teacher. There was a youth pastor, a youth counselor. There was a choir director. There was an organist. There was a little old lady. There was an elderly man. There was that person and that one and this one and that one. And there was a place. There was a sanctuary. There was a community. There was a congregation. There was a church done right. But how could it be? I can hear them now, long gone, many of them, responding with their eyes sparkling and a gentle smile breaking across their face to inspire us today. And I hear them saying, it's really very simple. We loved Billy. So is there a magic formula for church? You bet there is. There was. And there is. And now you may be able to say it with me from memory. We loved you so much. We were delighted to share with you not only the gospel of God, but our lives as well, because you had become so dear to us. So be it. May it be so. Church done right. Amen.
Galen and Susan are back, and I thought, Galen, you would at least have an amen there, or maybe even get us started in clapping. But we're so grateful, Bill, for the word that you gave to us this morning, church done right. And I would imagine for those of you who have been a part of this church community for generations, it's been especially moving for you to know the names and the places of which Bill spoke. And I hope it's been a word of encouragement and inspiration for those of us who are a little farther along in the journey and maybe don't know all of the names, but continue to seek to live into that call. So I'm going to ask that you would join me in prayer. This morning, God, we do thank you for your boundless, everlasting, reckless love and the grace that's been made known to us in your Son, Jesus Christ. We thank you, God, for the countless ways that your love has been reflected in and through the people of this church community throughout generations, where faith has been both caught and taught, where faith has become real with skin on it because of your love that has been very tangible through the people of this community. We thank you, God. We're really grateful, God, that you continue to love us, even when we don't always do church right, that your love has no bounds, no boundaries. And we dare to ask, God, that you would continue to infuse our lives with your love. Gracious and holy God, we ask that you would give us eyes to see, especially those who are in need of your holy love this day. Those who need the hair on their head tousled a little bit, who who need to be just recognized for who they are as beloved children of yours. God, we ask that you would give us a holy imagination, that we would grasp this truth that our lives actually have the impact, the possibility of reflecting your love and loving people to faith in you. And we thank you, God, that you've reminded us this morning of this holy calling that is upon each one of us. We bring before you this morning, God, those who find themselves in places that maybe they never expected to be, whether walking the journey of grief and loss. And God, we ask your spirit would continue to journey with them, reminding them they're not alone. We pray, God, you'd give us as brothers and sisters that calling to walk alongside as well. We're thankful, God, for slow but steady improvement for those who've been struggling with recovery, with illness. We continue to bring before you Don Pelto. Give him grace for this journey of healing, for Louise Shostek. And we bring before you Jack and Ann Weiss as Jack prepares to leave his transitional rehabilitation care and move back home as he waits for this hip replacement. God, we ask that you would go before both Jack and Ann in all of the details and all of the plans for this new chapter. And for those who are living with, battling cancer this day, God, we ask that you would continue to be on that journey with them. We bring before you Brenda Sherrato, Bruce Schreiber, Deb Berger's relative, Krista, so recently diagnosed with endometrial cancer. We pray, God, that you would reveal yourself in those places, in those communities where it seems many of us have given up. It seems that others have just discarded. I'm talking, God, what's happening locally in our communities and also around the world. And we pray, God, that you would show how you are at work through your people amidst the war with Israel and Palestine. It's been 6 months today, God, and we are asking for peace, for a change in the Middle East that would go from conflict to hope. God, we pray for a miracle. And we pray that for the people of Ukraine. God, end this war. And even though Haiti's no longer on the front screens of our news feeds or televisions, God, it's chaotic in Haiti, and we need your work to bring about peace. We pray for displaced people today at our borders and around the world, and we pray, God, for a place to call home. God, we ask that you would continue to do your work through your people. We're so thankful for organizations like Team World Vision and Covenant World Relief and Development, where we can be a part of transformation, of bringing hope and justice in places where injustice seems fraught. And we pray, God, that you would rise within us this compelling love to recognize the difference we can make because we are your own. We are your children, and we are led by your spirit, and we're infused by your love. So we pray, God, that we would live as saints, and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to close this morning by singing Together for All the Saints. This is a hymn that's beloved. We normally sing it on All Saints Sunday, but Bill has asked that we sing it this morning, thinking about the saints who've gone before us and then claiming our identity as 21st century saints, continuing to live in the love and the grace of Jesus. So may we sing with that intent, and please stand. on up. Just a few reminders as we leave from this place. Those who are interested in pursuing membership, you'll be meeting with leadership team members just to my left in the conference room. I want to remind you that we have ushers in the back and on the side to receive this morning's offering. And while we're not singing praise, the hymn of praise, we are grateful. And we give thanks to those who continue to support our church financially. We are also receiving a special offering for Covenant World Relief and Development. We received the offering last Sunday on Easter Sunday. If you didn't have the opportunity to give, just indicate that's where you want your offering to go as well. We'll be collecting money through the 14th. Those are my announcements. You'll have the opportunity to greet Reverend Bill Johnson at the back of the sanctuary following the postlude. Thank you again.
The best words I can give you and to leave with you are from the Apostle Paul, chapter 3, verses 16 to 21. I pray that out of his glorious riches he will strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, and that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power together with all the saints to know how wide, how long, how far, how deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you'll be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. And now to him who is able to do far more than all we could ask or imagine, by his power at work in us, be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus through all generations, forever and ever. Amen.